Hello, everybody. Welcome to Hopkins at Home. It's good to see everybody. My name is Jennifer Jarvis. I'm a book conservator for the Sheridan Libraries. Can everyone hear me okay? Good. All right. So this is the second class in the three-part mini course Love at the Libraries. And today I'm going to be talking to you and demonstrating for you some different historic letter locking techniques. And I hope that if you're ever in the need of a special letter writing technique for somebody you love, that you will think about using some of these techniques. So first, I have a few slides to show you. I have a brief PowerPoint presentation to show you. And then after that, I'm gonna kind of toggle back and forth between showing you three different historic models of a particular letter lock, and then I'm gonna demonstrate how to do that letter lock. So if you want to grab a piece of scrap paper and kind of fold along with me, you're more than welcome to do that. You don't have to. I always prefer to watch somebody do something first and then try it on my own, but whatever works for you. I know this recording will be available for you to refer back to should you wanna kind of learn along later. And I'm also gonna give you some really good resources that you can follow up with that'll give you more than you ever wanted to know about letter locking. Letter locking is just a very small part of a thousands of year old tradition of different ways of securing data and information. And going back from ancient Mesopotamia, where they used clay bullae to lock up and authenticate information, to today where we have our extravagant passwords and multi-step authentication. So this is just a small part of that tradition. And what I'm gonna be talking to you today about is a smaller part of that. I'm focusing on Western Europe and mostly the 16th and 17th centuries, which I should point out is before the invention of the envelope, which happened in the 19th century. So in the time that we're talking about, you would use the same piece of paper that you were writing your letter to fold into an envelope for posting it to whoever you were sending it to. So you can see here, and the example on the right is a letter from, I think, the early 17th century. I have more details later in the presentation, but and this is housed at the Folger Shakespeare Library. And you can see here, these kinds of letters exist in libraries and archives around the Western world. They're not particularly rare, but you can see here different pieces of evidence of how this might have been folded. You can see at the top left, there's a portion missing. This is a folded letter, so you can see like there's a triangle piece of paper missing there. You can see here where my cursor is circling. This is what's left of the lock, of the letter lock, and there's some wax underneath there. And then if you look down, you can see there's a series of vertical slits in the paper. So if you don't know what you're looking at, you might not know what, if any, of these pieces of evidence here are connected to how the letter was originally folded and locked. You can also see the crease lines, the fold lines, and the fact that here and here are the dirtiest portions of the letter, indicating, of course, that it was the exterior of the letter. So while these letters have existed in archives and libraries, it hasn't really been a field of study to figure out how these letters would have been originally folded and locked in order to post them. And it's kind of been tricky to reverse engineer when you're looking at a flat letter that's been unfolded, how it would have looked when it was folded. So the woman on your left is a conservator for MIT. Her name is Janet D'Ambrogio, and she is really the researcher, scholar responsible for the field of study that we know of as letterlocking today. And it was in fact her who coined the term letterlocking in 2009. And I think it makes a lot of sense that it was a conservator who kind of formalized this area of inquiry, this field of study, because we're trained to understand how things were made, in my case, books and library materials, to look at evidence and be able to see what is original to the object, what is not, what is added later, what is a hole that was intentional in a document, what is a hole that served an actual archival purpose, that kind of thing. So it makes sense that she's the one that was able to really formalize this. And she started looking into these letters in the early 2000s during an internship at the Vatican Secret Archives, where she would, in her spare time, try to recreate letters that she was looking at in the archives. And this, I guess this became a passion for her. And the person on the right, his name is Daniel Smith, and he's a lecturer at King's College London. And they sort of joined forces in 2013 to start really systematizing letterlocking, to categorize all the different types of letterlocks and describe them and put them into their historic context. And that kind of scholarly endeavor was precipitated by and really helped along by the discovery of the chest that you see in the image here, which lives now in The Hague, and it was sort of rediscovered in 2012 in The Hague. And it is the chest belonging to the postmaster and postmistress of The Hague from the last quarter of the 17th century. And what you see are about 2,600 letters in this chest. And you might wonder, well, why did these guys keep all of this mail? Well, in those days, postage was always paid by the recipient of a letter. So you would send your letter, and whoever was supposed to receive the letter would go to the post office and pay the postage fee. So of course, postmasters would collect various letters that were never collected, either because the recipient didn't want the letter, couldn't pay for the letter, maybe sometimes the recipient was dead or missing. So there's lots of reasons why letters would never be collected from the post office. And usually they were discarded or, you know, they weren't kept. But in this case, this couple, they decided to hang on to these letters, I guess in the hopes that they would at some point get their money for these letters. And it ended up, the chest ended up in The Hague, and as I said, it was discovered in 2012. And this is just, for this kind of study, this is a treasure trove, because if we go back to this previous slide with this letter here, there's pieces missing. The parts of the letter lock are missing here. So you're not going to be able to necessarily tell how this would have been folded just from one example. You need multiple examples of the same kind of letter lock in order to work out slowly, okay, this is how this piece of paper would have worked. This is where the seal would have gone. This is where different cuts were made. And so having just hundreds and hundreds of these kinds of letters really gave them just a wealth of information and allowed them to start naming all the different variations and tracking them. These letters came from all over Europe. So tracking what was used, you know, in France versus what was used in England. And I should say that there's also 600 at least of these letters that were never opened. So they have closed examples as well as open examples. So this really helped them try to start answering some of the questions, although as you can tell, it's still a nascent field of study. So trying to understand how letter locking techniques might have evolved over the centuries, trying to understand how somebody would have learned this. You know, there's not like a Diderot encyclopedia of letter locking techniques that we know of. There's not a manual of how to do this. So it seems to have been passed on from person to person. So how did that work? A good example is the poet John Donne. He, according to their research, had about 5 different ways that he liked to lock his letters depending on the situation. 4 of those ways they've widely documented elsewhere, and they seem to be common ways of locking your letters, but there's one that they've never seen anywhere else ever in there. And I think they've looked at about 250,000 letters in their research. So what does that mean? Did he create it himself? And why? Does it exist anywhere else? So these are the kind of questions that come out of this kind of research, and also trying to understand why would you use a particular technique over another? Did it convey a certain meaning to use a particular way of locking your letters? So here's just a slide of some historic materials that would have been used for letter writing and letter locking. On the top left, you see some awls, which are basically large needles stuck into handles, which makes them easier to use for piercing holes through materials. You've got some sealing wax here in the top center, different kinds of sealing wax. On the top right is an interesting alternative to sealing wax. These are paste wafers. So much like envelopes we use today, where you need a little bit of moisture to activate the adhesive in the envelope, you would take one of these paste wafers and put it on your letter and then apply a little bit of moisture, and that would seal your letter shut. In the bottom center, of course, you see different kinds of pens. And the bottom right is something called a wax jack, which is a particular kind of candle just for melting your sealing wax. Apparently, normal kinds of candles would burn too hot and would tend to burn your wax and kind of cause it to act a little strange. So this was a kind of candle invented in the 17th century, I believe, late 17th century, to perfect the art of using your sealing wax. And I'm going to show you in the demonstration some of the tools that I use and some alternatives. Next here, this is our first model, what we're going to make. This is categorized as a fold and tuck kind of letter lock. So you see the wax seal in the upper right portion of the second image. That's the only way that this letter would have been secured with that sealing wax. And so this is going to, of the 3 letters that we look at today, this is going to be the least secure. And then we're going to go up in levels of security as we progress. And so I just chose this one because I thought it was pretty charming and I thought it would be fun to make. So I'm going to stop sharing for just a minute and we're going to go to the demo and I'm going to show you how to do it. Okay, so this is a reproduction of a letter from the folder. And I just thought it would be more fun to fold what looked like an actual letter. Let me just go over quickly the tools that I've got. I've got an awl here, but you could just use a needle. Any kind of needle would be fine. I've got a knife here and a pair of scissors. This is just something, you need something to kind of push open some of the slits we're gonna cut. So, but it doesn't have to be a dedicated tool. Something to make your folds sharp is helpful. This is a folder, but you could also use just the edge of a ruler or anything else like that would work just as well. I've got my sealing wax here, but because we're in the library, I'm not going to light the candle to melt the sealing wax. but I just thought it would be nice to show you. As an alternative, I'm going to use some hot glue. It's a low temperature glue gun, but this works just fine. And you can actually buy glue gun sticks that are actually more like sealing wax. This is just a glitter glue stick that I got from my kids' arts and crafts store, but you can buy sealing wax sticks that go into your hot glue gun. I've got a seal here, but you could use a coin or anything else, metal that kind of has an impression. I've also had luck just using rubber stamps. It's a little bit trickier to peel that off once you've sealed your letter, but it does work. So you could just use a rubber stamp. And then I've got some floss here, some silk floss embroidery thread for one of the models we're gonna make, but you could use any kind of embroidery thread or even yarn or anything that you've got to hand. And okay, so again, you don't need to use any special kind of paper. I just thought it would be more fun to use handmade paper and a facsimile. So I'm gonna start my folding here. I'm going to fold in half horizontally. And don't worry too much about, this is the only letter actually that the folds are very precise at all. The rest of them aren't really. So I've got my fold in center fold here, and I'm going to fold a kind of a flap down here at the top, and it doesn't have to be super precise. You would just want it about maybe between a half an inch and an inch wide at the top. Press that down. All right, so I've got my bottom fold and this tab folded at the top. I'm going to flip the letter over. And this is, if you've ever done any origami, this fold is going to look really similar. I'm basically going to fold the top corners down until they meet in the center. Just like that. Let me see what I'm doing. Use my folder to piece that. Okay, so everybody see that? I've done that, and then this tab that's extending at the bottom, I'm just going to fold that up. Again, I'm not measuring anything. It doesn't have to be super precise. And these two little tabs here, I'm going to tuck them behind so they're in line with the rest of the letter. Okay, so we've got a triangle shape. Now I'm gonna flip it over just like that. And you see here, this little pocket that's created when I made this fold. And that's where we're gonna tuck the rest of this letter. So again, I'm gonna take these two corners and I'm gonna fold them in the middle. So they come down here, meet me just like this. I did one, and I'm going to do the other. As you get these folds, as they get thicker and thicker, you just have to work it down a little bit. All right, so see, I've got these two little flaps, and I'm just going to tuck them right into this little pocket here. There, that's all there is to it. So I would put my address, that one here, put my address on the front here. And then on the back, this is where it's tucked in. So this is where you want to secure it, or else it could come loose. So I'm going to take my glue here and seal it up.
first
model. So this is a silk floss letter. And this particular example is from 1610 in England, also from the Folger. And these letters I really like. They seem to be used primarily as correspondence that was casual in nature, intimate between friends or family members. You'll see when we go to do it that they typically will fit right in the palm of your hand. So that's really conducive to, if you want to keep your letter a secret, you can just hold it right in the palm of your hand. So that's an image of it closed. And you can see here the wax seal and then the frayed silk thread that was used to tie it up. And then the next slide here is the letter opened, or a letter, an example of this kind of letter opened. And you can see here on the image on the right where the exterior of the letter would be in the two seals and the little frayed edges of the silk thread. Another interesting thing about this kind of letter is that there is archival documentation showing that while men would have written these letters, they would still have often handed it off to their wives or other women in their household to do the actual threading, because I guess they couldn't figure out how to use a needle and thread. There's like a letter somewhere, I can't remember where a man is explaining that, you know, he gave this to his wife and she was tying it up for him. Yeah, I think we're ready to move on to making that. So here's a couple of examples of this letter that I made already. Let me get another model here. So again, I'm going to start with my sheet and then I'm going to fold it in half horizontally, just like I did before. And then you want to end up with a narrow horizontal strip, but however you fold it to get there, it doesn't really matter. I'm just going to fold each side up to that center line. And then do that again. Right, so that's what you end up with. And then we're going to fold it in half this way. Right, so you can see how, well, my hands are pretty small, but you could conceal that pretty easily. All right, so this is one step up from the first letter in terms of security, because what we're going to do is poke a hole through it and then tie our thread through it before we seal it. So I've got my awl there, but again, you could use a needle. Just poke the hole through there. Got my thread. And I'm just going to wind that around. The knot really isn't anything for security purposes. It's just to hold everything together while you get your sealing wax. It's the wax that's going to lock that down. Okay, that's all tied up. And then take my wax glue from these. And then you want to seal both sides. There's your letter. And then to open it, you would just take your scissors or your knife and just cut along the threads there and open it. Again, because the letter has to also be the envelope, like you'll see, like in this next example, this is like a double sheet of paper, and there is I think you can see there is writing on the other side there, but the right hand side is left blank intentionally because that then gets folded to create the envelope. So that's one way of doing it. And I've also seen examples where there's just multiple sheets laid in. Another security measure was writing your letter and locking it and then enclosing it in another kind of fake letter to kind of disguise that you've got this other letter in there that is going perhaps somewhere else or to somebody else. So in that case, I guess you would still have locked the interior letter too. I think most of the time they would, again, whoever's writing the letter would have been aware that they need to leave ample blank space for folding the envelope. The research is still ongoing, but what I've read is that there was a general, if you follow the progression of letter locking, the locks look more and more like what we think of now as an envelope. And then in the 19th century, the actual envelope is invented. And then at that point, you don't need these letter locking techniques anymore when you have the separate envelope. But it does seem as though the shape of the envelope that we know of today is not accidental, that it came from these letter locking forms and the way that the letter locks were trending in their appearance, if that makes sense. Okay, so this is the last model that we're going to do. This is called a triangle lock with vertical slits, and this particular example is from England in 1587. And this is the most secure of the kind of locks that we're going to do today, and I'm going to show you a couple reasons for that. Okay, so I've got my letter here. And the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to cut my lock. So this is going to be a paper lock. I'm going to cut it out of here. And this doesn't have to be anything precise. So there is my lock. And one of the reasons this is so secure is, can you see the lines in the paper with this light? These are the laid and chain lines in handmade paper. So this is how paper would have looked at this time. It was all handmade, of course, from linen rags. And the metal molds that were used to form each sheet of paper had these copper wires. And so this is the shadow of that copper wire. So if you're cutting your lock from the same piece of paper that you've written your letter on, somebody who receives the letter and is worried about the integrity of the contents could take the lock, remove what they could of the lock and double check that against the paper used to write the letter, just to confirm that it is in fact the same lock, that nobody has unlocked the letter and then tried to replace it with another lock. So I got my lock and I'm gonna fold the letter and I'm going to fold that in half. I'll just fold it up again. Different shape than the other letters. All right, so I've kind of got this fatter rectangle than this one. And now I'm going to cut a vertical slit, and I'm going to use a chisel just because it's easier for me, but you could also use a knife or an exacto knife or whatever you have. Okay, so I've got my slits. I'm just gonna make sure that that is open fully all the way. You can see that it is. So now I've got my lock and I just need to get that in there. Depending on how heavy or thick your paper is, it might be helpful to just have a little tool to poke that first part of the lock through the slit. Okay, so then, and then just pull it until it stops. So you can see here you've got just a small portion of that lock pulled through, but that's all you need. So then you're going to take either a knife or a pair of scissors and just cut that vertically in half down to slit. You see that? And then I'm going to just splay those two halves out just like that to lock that in there. Everybody see that? It's kind of the same color. All right, so then that's kind of it. You are just going to use your sealing wax to seal that up. Fold your lock. Just tear off any extra that you've got there. And that is your locked letter with an actual paper lock on it. Okay, so the second link here, letterlocking.org, that is Jana D'Ambrogio and Daniel Smith's website. So there are dozens of videos of these models and lots of others that you can follow along with, as well as a dictionary of letterlocking terms. What else is on there? I think just a background to their research. And she does have a YouTube channel as well, but the website links directly to the videos. So that letterlocking.org website is really all you need. The first link, brienne.org, is the website for the Postal Museum in The Hague, where that trunk of letters lives. And so that is the Letterlocking Project's website for that project to research all aspects of those letters that were in that trunk. And they have a fun online exhibit about all about letter locking. And that the exhibit might have more information about like the history of the Postal Service in general in Europe. I know there's a few slides of the exhibit that go into that in more detail. And then I think I saw a question about how I learned to do this. I took a workshop with Jana D'Ambrogio in probably 10 years ago, maybe a little less than 10 years ago anyway, when she first started kind of formalizing the study. So that's how I learned about it. I have my email address there on that slide, so please reach out if you have any other questions, and I'll be happy to try to answer them. And otherwise, I hope to see you all again at another workshop, and hopefully one day in person.